So I would like to start with a short fragment about the installation of the Brainiac, which is the Flemish Tier 1 high-performance computer currently hosted at the University of Leuven, KU Leuven, which I think is a nice way to start to talk about research infrastructures. And it's also a good test to see if the e-infrastructure, a big important part of it, connectivity, is working. So it's a time-lapse fragment of the installation of the supercomputer in the data center in Leuven. But when I first became acquainted with the concept of research infrastructures, I was of the opinion that the focus was mainly on technological equipment, digital tools and data sets, computing, such as the HPC, and storage. By now, I realize that communication networks, creating awareness, knowledge sharing, and training the next generation of researchers in using machines such as the APC, are integral and important part of research infrastructures. Without it, many research infrastructures would be used only by a few. And a collaborative effort in bringing different people together from different backgrounds is probably the most characteristic feature of a research infrastructure. For example, this Brainiac HPC, like I said, it's hosted at KU Leuven, but it's a shared resource. And by pooling effort and jointly developing research infrastructures, individuals and institutions such as KU Leuven can get access to equipment they would otherwise not be able to afford. I don't think that digital humanities researchers are already in need of this kind of computing power, but I was talking to Nicolas yesterday and he said that, well, in France we're noticing that actually in digital humanities we're kind of using a lot of the same tools that, for example, people at CERN are using. So I might be mistaken and there are perhaps already humanities researchers using HPCs. In any case, with the growing number of digital humanities data sets and new technological skills the new generation of humanities researchers are gaining, and also thanks to initiatives like DARIA, I think, it might happen sooner than we think that we need this kind of computing power for data processing. So there's definitely a digital transformation of research, also in the humanities, and these days technology is everywhere. In most, if not all, research projects, hard and software components are used aplenty. And if you look at the research data lifecycle, I'm sure you've seen one kind of representation of it. It's, for me, hard to think of the main concepts such as creating, processing, analyzing, preserving, providing access and reusing data. It's hard for me to think of them as concepts taking place on paper. For me, this is already digital. Policymakers and funders alike are encouraging contingency projects with an IT component. Also in the humanities, this is the case. And as a result, new tools, databases, and data models sprout from every research project. With this, the original goal of sharing and collaboration is surpassed by the conviction that there is a need for this particular software or that custom developed database. This is not entirely a bad thing because it also drives innovations and brings new perspective to the use of digital components in humanities researchers. But the problem probably lies more in the sustainability of the developed tools and databases after a project's lifetime. So I was asked to talk today about my experiences with research infrastructures and specifically about the challenges faced concerning sustainability. But I also want to talk about the opportunities they bring to creating excellent research through collaboration. And I will start with some personal experiences and projects I'm involved at KU Leuven before I move on to the important role that national and pan-European research infrastructures such as DARIA and DARIA-related projects can have in providing researchers with best practices and support in maintaining access to innovative tools, databases, and data sets. Of course, every talk is based on personal experiences and specific viewpoints. And my opinion on how sustainability of infrastructure should be organized is undoubtedly influenced by our role as service provider of the University of Leuven. Before I continue, I want to a bit clarify our role. Like Nicolas said, it's quite special. I don't think that there are many universities that have a similar structure. But a bit of context, I work for Libis, and Libis is a part of the university library. We are a provider of library, archival, museum-related applications and services. And as such, we provide tools and services for the management of the library, archival, and heritage collections of the university. But we also, a bit more recently in our 45 years of existence, support research-related services for the university, both through projects with research groups, as in partnership with other research support services, such as the Documentation and Research Division of KU Leuven, which is called DOC, and ICTS, the ICT Services of KU Leuven. For example, Libis takes care of the technical support of the current research information system, the CRIS system. And this slide shows the KU Leuven data lifecycle. Everyone usually makes their own. Ours is still a work in progress. And what you see here is that every aspect of the lifecycle has a green box. And these green boxes list the research-specific services offered by Libis, ECTS, and DOC, so all research-supporting services. And this is to help researchers find appropriate tools in each phase of their research. It's the result of the KU Leuven data policy, which states that researchers have the responsibility to keep their research data available for at least 5 years. And on the other hand, the university says that it has the responsibility to offer services and tools for the good management of research data. But the thing is that Libis also wears another hat. We're also a division of Leuven Research and Development. And this enables us to go our own way. We don't always have to do things for the library, with the library. We can explore new services and new markets, both within KU Leuven and outside of the university. But we're not there to make a profit. We're not a spin-off or a company, to be clear. We're an integral part of the university. What we do have is a responsibility to provide durable services to both partners from within and outside the organization. And this means that we have to maintain infrastructure, tools, and services for a longer time than the normal funding period, and invest in our infrastructure and keep the service portfolio up to date and innovative. These roles mean that we have to plan well ahead, both strategically as well as financially, which also means we have to set some money aside to be able to execute future investment plans. And be able to innovate and add new features to our services that reflect our partner needs. So this can sometimes be quite challenging since most of our incomes and resources come from external partnerships. We have a team of about 20 people and only 4 people of them are paid by the university itself. All of the rest is through projects, partnerships, contracts that we have within and outside of the university. So we continuously have to find a balance between developing standardized services to share costs across all of our partners and projects, and then also offering enough flexibility and possibilities for cost and development to allow for innovation. And in order to demonstrate the importance of a standardized service portfolio infrastructure, which to me is a key component in providing digital sustainable digital services and research infrastructures, I would like to talk about how we organize our infrastructure portfolio using a concrete example of a project we're involved at KU Leuven. We have several ones, but I don't have time to go into all of them, so I picked the one that addressed most of the aspects of challenges and opportunities. After that, I will continue to focus on the bigger picture and address the role that national and pan-European infrastructures such as DARIA and DARIA-related projects can have in helping digital humanities deal with these challenges related to sustainability. So I would like to start with a short presentation of the EDEM project, Integrated Database for Early Music, which, like I said, shows all of the challenges we usually have in projects when working with digital humanities as a technical partner. So in 2013, we submitted together with the Alameda Foundation an infrastructure proposal. And the Alameda Foundation is an international center for the study of music in the Low Country. They digitize medieval music manuscripts at a very high resolution at international renowned libraries such as the Biblioteca Vaticana, British Library, Royal Libraries, but also as far as Brazil for their research. They not only do research on the manuscripts, they also perform the content of these polyphonic music manuscripts. To be able to exploit the digital versions they digitized, they were in need of a research platform for the comparative visualization and description of manuscripts. The project was submitted on a Hercules infrastructure call. It's a Flemish investment fund, and it's for funding medium and large scale infrastructures. And the interesting thing about Hercules is that it only finances infrastructure. It doesn't finance researchers. Only for acquisition or construction of infrastructures itself. So the project was accepted, but since the funders wanted to fund as many projects as possible in the same call, everyone had a huge budget reduction by almost 50%. I suppose that many of you know this kind of things happening. So the budget cost was, of course, not without consequences. The main budget was to be preserved for the long-term preservation of the digital manuscripts. It left very little resources for the development of the research database, the website, high-resolution viewer they needed for the comparative research of the manuscripts. But the worst thing was that all of the budget for post-project maintenance was completely cut. Normally, they could get you could get on those projects a 3 years maintenance support cost, but because of this high number of good projects they wanted to fund, this was cut for everyone. From the very start of the proposal writing, this is something we always try to do, we had discussed the issue of post-project maintenance and storage costs with a research partner, realizing that it's usually difficult for them to cough up large amounts each year after a project financing has ended. And for Alamiri, it was a double challenge, because normally when it's about KU Leuven collections, we try to find a solution for that. We try to ask for a project cost, but then afterwards we absorb the cost for the after the project lifetime. But the collections were not KU Leuven collections. They were from the Vatican British Library, who are perfectly possible, capable of preserving their own things, which they of course also do. But yes, they needed access to specific manuscripts, which they had digitized. The overall budget cut, and especially the lack of any budget for project sustainability, does influence the finance selection of tools and technologies for the construction of the integrated database for early music. So, after a detailed analysis of the requirements of the Alamiri Foundation and possible tools, we agreed with our partner to reuse a number of existing tools we were already using for mainly our museum partners, heritage partners, and to combine them with new open source tools to limit the license costs. We as Libis were also willing to invest our own time and resources in some of the selected tools, on the precondition that we could share this development with our other partners so that we could spread the cost over more partners and that we could guarantee the long-term sustainability. In this preparatory phase of the project, we clearly communicated also about the pros and cons of these tools, because of course we were working with existing tools, not custom developed. They had to make some compromises. I'm not going to linger too long here. It's just a very simplified overview of the tools that we selected, that we used, and the workflows. So they have either disks or using FTP transfer upload tools, which for delivering the digital material, which goes through an entire ingest workflow, which is fully OIS compliant, long-term preservation compliant, to finally being stored the digital manuscripts in our long-term preservation repository, Rosetta, which is an Ex Libris product. It's not our own development. We also use tools and services provided by other technology partners. For the research database, we decided to use Collective Access. It's an open source database, which is mainly used for describing museum heritage collections, but it has a very flexible data model. You can create any kind of data model, a relational data model in that database, and it's based on the principle of CDOC-CRM, which means that it was also very suitable for what Alamiri had in mind for their research. Another aspect that was interesting for Collective Access is that it has a very user-friendly backend. They would still be able to extend their data model even after the project's lifetime and financing would have ended. They could create new fields, new templates, and so on. Also, there's good rights management options, which allow them to collaborate with researchers from all over the world. For the public access to the metadata, we used Omeka. It just represents the basic metadata. If people want to get access to the research metadata, they can get an account for collective access. But the most important investment went to the new viewer, a new visualization for manuscripts, which was a very important requirement in the project, and I'll tell a bit more about that. So they had some viewer requirements for their high resolution images, quick without loss of quality, easy navigation within a manuscript, full screen views. They didn't want to have big toolbars that would take up the space, extensive zooming options in single fluid motions, focused on a selected area. Those are all quite standard. Most viewers can handle these things. Another thing that wasn't so standard was that they wanted to be able to easily put folios from different manuscripts together to make different frames and so on. So what Alamira proposed was actually the virtual volume viewer as a possible viewer. It was also an open source viewer that was developed by the University of Sheffield, but we did some research to check if it was okay, and we noticed that it was no longer actively maintained. It's something we always do when we use open source projects to check the strength and activity of a community. And it was completely missing for the virtual volume project, and also the code language in which the tool was written was no longer up to date. Last the updates were made in 2007. So after a known investigation, Libis proposed to Alamire to use Mirador, which is one of the viewers that implements the full client functionalities of the International Image Interoperability Framework. And I suppose many of you, or almost all of you, will have heard about this framework. And since sharing image collections is at the core of IIIF, and Mirador allows the easy comparisons of folios from different objects, it was a suitable choice for the project. We had to do some fine-tuning. At the time, the version 2 was going to be released, and there were still some bugs there. We had to make some adaptations to fulfill all of Alamira's requirements, but it was, in the end, a good choice. What we did is we made a plugin for Rosetta so that the long-term preserved material, actually the digital representations made of the preserved material, would be grabbed directly out of the digital long-term preservation repository for visualization. So Mirador is completely open source, fully featured and configurable. We're now in the process of upgrading to the next version and adding some additional features. So since there was limited budget from Alamire, we decided to invest some of our own resources in this, in the hope that other research groups would also be interested in using these tools and that we could in this way make the service sustainable. And Mirador really has been a huge success. It has attracted a lot of interest from other research groups, dealing mainly with manuscripts studies, but also photographic material, archival material. But also our GLAM partners, our library, archive, and museum partners, were very interested in the tool. And in this way, we can retrieve our investments and continue to build on diversifying our services for researchers. So Mirador is now added to our service catalog and put to use of other projects such as the Magister Dixit project of the Lexio Research Group. And currently we're working on a new project called Digital Hersel, where we're extending IIIF and the Mirador infrastructure with new features. And also in a few months time, we will have an open annotation repository available for that. So, of course, we have a lot of challenges, but this is from a service provider point of view. I hope I won't step on any toes by saying this. It's not. I know that you are more technically advanced, but we deal sometimes with research groups that are not that digital yet, even though they sometimes might call themselves digital humanists. But sustainability is our main recurring challenge, of course, in our collaboration with all research groups. We also work outside of the humanities. Also there we have the problem with neurosciences, we have this problem with movement analysis, we have this problem. It's always a problem. But it's definitely not the only one. So the first challenge that usually arises at the beginning of a project especially in the case that we are only contacted after a project is funded and we're not part of the calculation of the initial budget, is that, well, the budget is underestimated. They're all dreaming of the perfect infrastructure able to deal with 10 different use cases, and they think that one IT person has the competences to build this all, but this is no longer the case in IT. We have web developers, people specialized in database management, server architecture, and so on. So it's quite a diverse group, and someone that knows PHP doesn't know Ruby on Rails, for example. And even on specific infrastructure calls, like the Hercules calls, they still want to put a lot of researchers on the payroll, even though it's for financing research infrastructures. So it's always difficult to find a good balance there. And well, while doing things yourself might seem cheaper than working with your research institute service provider, you must keep in mind that we are not there to make a profit. We're just there to build sustainable, reusable, and shareable services. It means that they have to last longer, they have to be robust enough to last longer than just the project. Our costs, they include hardware, software, personal resources, which is usually the most expensive thing, something they forget that their own time also costs money. It takes time to keep things up to date, make sure the security is okay, something that's getting more and more important now also with the new data regulation that the European Commission is putting us up with, which is important, of course, privacy of data. Another challenge is, like I said, limited technical know-how. There's a lot of traditional thinking still taking place. They've seen it somewhere, they want to have something very similar, but yet a bit different and, as if possible, also better. They usually have a great number of very unspecific requirements that they hope they solve all their problems. So it's very difficult for them to make very concrete requirements. It's something that is definitely improving. There's also almost no interest, I noticed, in the use of standards and data interoperability. I've seen a number of researchers do the exactly same thing as their European colleagues, yet collaboration on the uses of systems or data exchange is not in the picture. And when I ask why are you not just using the same database then instead of setting up your own? Yes, but we got specific funding to create this new database and this new website. Of course, this is also a problem created by the funders then. Yes, sustainability, it's, like I said, a major challenge. It's seldom taken into account. I think it's much related to the fact that in the past, their faculty IT support took care of these things. But now things are getting more complex, infrastructure is getting more complex, and are more intensive in maintenance. So also the IT support services can't handle this anymore. They have to think of the total cost of ownership of providing support. And as a service provider, we need to take into account also that these partners often ask for quite a lot of technical support because they're limited technical skills. For example, for data imports, data normalization, we are often asked for help. And it's quite difficult for me to keep a balance between the costs and keeping the researchers happy with our services. It sometimes gives me a headache to find the right balance in this. But of course, we wouldn't be doing this if we didn't see the benefits. We're not a commercial organization or a spin-off. But by providing support services for key stakeholders of a research university, which KU Leuven is, we also fulfill part of our university's mission. And in this way, we also try to strengthen our position, the role of Libis within the university. What we usually do is to go for collaboration. We try to work together with research groups to achieve our goals. We try to make sure that they are willing to share the developments we make with other research groups. And the willingness to collaborate and share developments is growing because they're understanding now that they just can't keep these things for themselves. We also go for a clear communication on the limitations and what they can expect for the budget they have at their availability. The total cost of ownership, it's a concept not yet well understood. And we don't say, take care of it yourself. We try to help them with finding alternative financing mechanism for the post-project sustainability. I think also for the humanities researchers, it can have can be of benefit to work with a technical research support service, not only Libis. There are a number at KU Leuven, and every university has them. Library often also supports these services. And but why I think we have more access to both financial and personnel resources to execute technology projects. We can interpret and translate the research needs into technical requirements. It's my job, for example, I'm in between the researcher and the programmer. I do the translation, which is very hard in both directions. The programmers are also not always easy to work with. So we can provide qualitative, scalable, affordable, and reusable services. Especially the reusable is important. Our service catalog means that we can provide these services time over again. We can link up to other service providers and vendors to achieve technical innovation. And we are probably perhaps the best guarantee for technical and financial sustainability. We don't have a big flow of people going on. People, technical personnel usually stays longer with us. And we can, I think, also serve a kind of bridge between digital humanities researchers and research infrastructures such as EUDAT, EGI, but also DARIA. But enough about what I think from my service provider point of view, what it should be about. I would also like to look at the bigger picture about sustainable research infrastructures on a pan-European and global scale. So in the next 5 points, I will provide some reflections on how I think sustainable digital research infrastructure can exist on this pan-European level. Well, one of the main issues, and point one, problem one, innovation sustainability, one of the main issues with research infrastructure, being them local, national, or even pan-European, is the lack of sustainable funding through structural funds. The dependency on project funding also limits the innovation potential of many research infrastructure. First of all, because long-term planning is depending on whether or not you can get new money collected in the next funding phase. And there's also the chance that at a certain moment, a project has gotten the most out of a specific call. The funders might just not be interested in your project anymore. And this results in a scarcity of budget, and of course then also a slowdown and even a standstill of developments, which means that after a certain time your infrastructure is just end of life. And it's specifically challenging in staying at the forefront of excellent science requires the investment and production of innovative digital projects in order to maintain the interest of funders and get new funds. So long-term commitment funding is an a priori requirement for innovation, since it also allows for ambitious development targets. Another challenge is the lack of structural funding brings is the inability to attract and keep highly qualified research infrastructure managers and technical staff because of lack of job security and insecure career paths. After a few years, most people move on to a new job that offers them more security, and that leaves behind a huge knowledge gap. Also here, perhaps collaboration with service provider will give some additional security because there's, like I said, less coming and going of technical stuff. And I think also embedding of knowledge management in your organization, in your research infrastructure is an important aspect. Excuse me. It can be said that only those research infrastructures that innovate and keep attracting new users will have the strongest case in presenting their value to funders. And DARIA, I think, can support research infrastructure managers and communities by helping them to fully exploit synergies and integration activities between smaller regional, national, and other pan-European research infrastructures. Like Frank yesterday said, it's not necessary to reinvent the wheel, but the problem is that you often don't know what is there, which projects you can collaborate in. DARIA can also help identify the needs of humanities researchers and gaps of the research and development to help steer the innovation process of research infrastructures. They can provide training programs for humanities researchers that will lead to the increased use of existing researchers to show the added value to the funders. They can create awareness around sustainability and the benefits of collaborating and investing in existing research infrastructures instead of starting a new project. Sorry. So the second challenge, data sustainability. The sustainability of research infrastructures largely depends on their availability to provide and share data, preferably in a documented and in a somewhat standardized way as well. Daria has a specific challenging mission here because of the diverse user communities in the domain of digital humanities. My experience with Humanities datasets is that there is a very limited or even no use of standards, both on the level of data formats, but also for the descriptive metadata. Of course, this is quite normal because you can't compare Babylonian clay tablets with 17th century iconography. But even within the same research topic, there are often no common descriptive standards used. In many cases, researchers will have looked at what their colleagues are doing, taking over some of the aspects of the data model, but interpreting them in their own way. For example, when I was a student, I did my master paper on post-medieval archaeology. I don't really do anything with it anymore. But at the time, I had to describe and analyze and classify a huge collection of pottery. And I was looking for what my predecessors had done. What model could I use to make my my database? And there was nothing to be found. So I just looked at other outputs, theses, PhDs, and did my own thing with what they had done before. So there's definitely still, I think, still today, a challenge there. Of course, every project has their specific research questions, needing specific data. It's definitely necessary to leave flexibility when concerning the collection of research data. But it should be possible to work on a common set of high-level elements within the same topic, at least. The heterogeneity of the data, as well as the lack of proper documentation, will otherwise limit the aggregation and reuse potential of different data sets. The effort researchers will have to put into interpreting and transforming the data to their own specific needs will create a barrier if not dealt with properly. I think Daria has a very important role to play to creating awareness on the importance of standardization. For me, their role is a bit similar to that of Europeana. I started my career on European digital projects in my, let's say, IT career, not my my archaeological career. I started that career on European digital projects at the Royal Museum of Art and History, one of the 10 federal scientific research institutes in Belgium who function on a federal level. So at the time that we had our first Europeana-related project, the museum was not well acquainted with standards at all. Our in-house collection management database was based on the Spectrum standard, but none of the curators, researchers, nor the museum application staff really knew what the standard was about, had looked at the definitions, and were using many of the fields in the way they thought was the right way. Sometimes they even created new fields while there were perfect fields available in the database. When comparing the museum sector to the library sector, which I admit has a less complex data, but they have a very long existence experience in data sharing, the entire museum sector, and not only in Belgium but throughout Europe, largely held only unstructured data sets that needed quite a lot of effort to harmonize them and bring them together. And Europeana and its related aggregation projects had a huge influence in the creation of both awareness and knowledge about data standardization, but also data licensing and open data. And you don't have to be a fan of EDM, the Europeana data model, to see that they brought this kind of value to the partners that were involved in Europeana-related projects. And Daria, for me, is in pole position to support the development of a culture of sharing, use, reuse, and support. They can also support multidisciplinary science. They can help reduce the heterogeneity of data, promote data management and stewardship, and good data documentation and management is crucial when not using standards. So if you're not following standards, at least provide your data documentation. They can point researchers to trusted repository of high quality data sets. Perhaps it's even interesting to put up a kind of star rating system that says ranks the openness and the reusability of data. They can perhaps make available core data experts to provide best practice guidelines and assist researchers in creating FAIR data. FAIR data being data and digital objects that should be findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. So DARIA can also serve, I think, as an intermediate between research infrastructures and infrastructures, such as AUDAT, EGI. It's a huge barrier for researchers, not only from humanities, from every domain, I think, to step up to AUDAT and to start using their services. Well, they might offer very cheap storage solutions for their project. The third problem is sustainable partnerships. Like in the example of the construction of Brainiac supercomputer, large investments in innovative research infrastructures are often not possible without collaboration. Also, funders are more and more looking for high usage of funded research infrastructures. They do not want to invest in something that is only being used 10% of its time. Unfortunately, collaboration is not always so easy. There are several barriers, such as political, financial, legal, and even social ones that need to be cleared. Belgium is again a great example of such a problem. We have three supercomputers, one for Flanders, one for the Walloon-Brussels region, and the federal one also has one. This one is only used by the Meteorological Institute for processing and visualizing climate data, and by the Natural Sciences Museum and Africa Museum. This probably means that the machine is not used to its full potential. And it's not, and probably also the Flemish one. I'm sure that there's still space left, so the federal level could use that if they wanted. But it's not a problem created by the scientists themselves. It's because of the complex political landscape in Belgium. And there are several more examples to give like this, and I think you can probably, hopefully not as many as in Belgium, but think of some similar cases in your country. Well, the good news is that there is an increasing global nature of the scientific community interested in using research infrastructures. New stakeholders are attracted to be part of a broad scientific community that enables research and use of state-of-the-art instruments. And DARIA is in a position to explore and indicate pathways for digital humanities projects and research infrastructures to collaborate and lead the digital humanities away from this individualist approach and national interests. They can also provide guidance on access to research infrastructures and data. DARIA can help in the support to data management optimization and promote open data policy, which is essential to enlarge the impact of research infrastructure and to increase its usage. Perhaps they can also look out and apply for joint funding mechanisms, but also for joint procurement, something that national organizations and especially regional ones are not capable of doing so easily. And they can coordinate joint activities, of course. I think also DARIA has an important role to strengthen the European position of digital humanities research within an international context. And the strategy for its evolution by outreach, training, user workshops and conferences is the way to go. The scale of future projects and the change in the global landscape requires outreach beyond Europe to ensure long-term sustainability and future innovation. And I think that the DAZIR project that was also presented yesterday is very valuable for DARIA to make a good start here. Okay, then there are the challenges of sustainable skills. So educated staff and research infrastructure users are indispensable for high quality usage of research infrastructures, of course. And in order to broaden the user community, sustainable training and knowledge exchange on a number of skills and experiences is needed. Training, knowledge creation, and sharing of expertise is already something that is high on the DARIA priority list. But training should probably not only be limited to research-related topics and the usage of research infrastructure. Managing digital humanities projects and infrastructures requires a huge set of skills that are not typically part of a researcher's curricula. Think of management, government, funding opportunities, user involvement, public engagement, training, human resources, industrial collaborations, but also conception, design, execution, commissioning, operation, decommissioning of infrastructures. And there are other things like business modeling, which humanities researchers has experience in business modeling. It's not something that was part of my education. Oh, sorry. I clicked the wrong button. So Daria is in a position to provide continuous upskilling of digital humanities researchers and also research infrastructure managers. They can support the transfer of best practices, organize mentoring programs between an exchange between experienced and less experienced users, and training experiments. They can stimulate knowledge transfer, not only of researchers, but also of the supporting personnel. They can facilitate the organization of staff exchanges. And perhaps it might also be interesting for them to do active knowledge and personnel exchange between service providers and digital humanities researchers, so that service providers can gain a better understanding of the common needs and problems faced on the technical level by the digital humanities. The final challenge, and probably the core one, is financial sustainability. So while most universities and funding organizations are aware of the problematic maintenance and support issues for research infrastructures produced as part of research projects, the mindset to support these digital infrastructures has not yet changed enough. On the other hand, it would also be naive, I think, to believe that universities and funding organizations would be able to financially support and maintain all of the developed research tools and databases. I think also for Daria, they are not in the possibility to maintain and support everything that is produced. For universities, they would do well to have a clear research infrastructure policy, much as is already the case for the more widely spread research data policies, since it could help provide clarity and direction in relation to the management of local research infrastructures. And Daria can play a very important role here by supporting smaller distributed research infrastructures to gain financial sustainability. By simplifying, for example, discoverability of these services so that the user community can grow and that their value can be demonstrated to the funders. Simplifying the discoverability of these services will also hopefully help users to better understand the relevance of research infrastructures. Jennifer gave a nice example yesterday about her wish that in a few years' time, the medievalist professor will come to her and say, oh, thank you for Daria and all you have done for my students. There's still a lot of work there. There are still many humanities researchers that are unaware of the potential of Daria and its related projects. What Daria can also do is provide a shared language for service descriptions. I don't think most researchers have the experience in writing and managing service catalogs. They can also help increase the visibility of service offerings by organizing platforms for training, workshops, demonstrations, and Daria Marketplace is a good example of this. They can train and assist research infrastructure managers also in the financial planning and the business modeling, but also in setting up open source projects and managing open source communities. Something that is often forgotten with open source projects is that it's very intensive. It asks a lot of personnel resources because managing a community takes a lot of personnel resources. But it is, if you want to have a successful open source project, you have to do this. They can also help in pointing them to similar projects for participation and collaboration instead of having them reinvent the wheel. So those were my thoughts about it. I always appreciate it when I can do a talk like this because it allows me to read up on some things that are already for a long time on my reading list. So if you want to get some further information, here are some references. I thank you for your attention, and if there are questions, I'm happy to take them.